Okay, I'm. So this is pretty going to be pretty informal. If you don't understand something, feel free to stop me. Not a problem. Happy to answer questions during the presentation or whatever. But what I'm going to try and give you an idea of is I'm not a farmer. I'm not involved in agriculture. I'm an electrical engineer. So this talk is going to try and give you a bit of an idea of how engineering and technology impacts on agriculture and food and farming, etc. And the particular area that I'm going to talk about is field portable sensors for farming in the 21st century, which is an area that we are working on as electrical engineers. We are involved with people in agriculture, etc., from the point of view of how our technology can be applied to agriculture and food production, etc. So this is me, and I'm the head of what's called the Microelectronics Research Group, which you might think is a long way separated from agriculture and food production, but I'll show you how this kind of technology can impact on food production in the 21st century. And I'm from electrical engineering in the Faculty of Engineering and Mathematical Sciences. Okay, so first of all, I suppose, what is sensing? Sensing is the process of basically measuring or gaining information on something, right? Some parameter, whatever it might be. And that's basically the sort of very generic description of what is sensing. So just to give you an example of something you're obviously familiar with, the cochlear in your ear converts sound pressure-induced movement from sound waves that impinge on your eardrum and converts that into an electrical signal that the brain can perceive as sound. So the process of sensing is the process of taking something which is a sound pressure-induced movement into an electrical signal, and then you can do something with the electrical signal. So that's what sensing is. And once you have that electrical signal, then you can do all sorts of things with it, right? And your brain does certain things with it in terms of interpreting it as sound. If you have an electrical system that can sense things, a microphone, of course, does exactly the same thing as your ear does and converts sound pressure waves into an electrical signal, which can then be amplified, just as is happening now as I'm speaking, and amplifies it so that you can hear it as well. So that's what sensing in a general term means. And of course, once you sense something, you can then either respond to it, or you can use that information or to control something. Okay, so then the question is, what is it that you want to sense on a farm? So in one case, you can look at soil parameters and crop parameters. So one of the most important things on farms, and especially in the context of Australia, is water, right? We are a very dry continent. So if you can measure the parameters of the soil and sense the parameters of the soil, sense the parameters of a crop in terms of its hydration, is it water stressed, etc., then you can perhaps use that information to control water usage, minimise the water usage, and reduce wastage, cost, and obviously impact on the environment. Then another thing that you could sense is nutrient content in the soil or the biomass of what's growing in a crop, and also hence determine what nutrient requirements there may be at a specific time during the growing season. And this is targeted at minimising fertiliser use, and targeting fertiliser use where it's needed rather than just everywhere. And once again, and you'll see this as a general theme running throughout, minimising runoff and obviously improving the environmental impact of such things. Another thing you could sense is either detecting weeds or disease on crops or where there's environmental damage. And once again, this is targeted at reducing the use of pesticides or herbicides, and hence minimising their use and cost, and hence also minimising resistance to these pests and herbicides. And the other one, of course, in terms of measuring contamination of crops, and in particular in terms of meat, if you could measure or sense that, then you can improve food quality and safety. So I'm going to give you a bit of a flavour of how sort of sensors from an electrical engineering point of view can and are used in farming to improve all of this, all of these parameters that I've listed here in terms of water usage and fertiliser usage and pesticide usage to reduce costs and also to minimise environmental impact. Oops. Yep, okay. So the next thing is, okay, so we want to sense these things. How do we measure them? How do we sense them? Well, you know, there's a whole range of ways of doing this. One of the most useful and ways of doing it is sensing with light. Because if you sense with light, it means that you don't actually have to physically be in contact with something, right? You don't, I mean, you can measure moisture in soil by sticking a probe into the soil and measuring moisture content, but you'd like to do it without actually sticking something into the soil. And the reason for that is because you'd like to do it on either from a vehicle or from a drone, airborne, flying around, things like that, because farming in Australia, of course, is very large scale, very large area, and so covering such huge areas is really impractical if you have to physically be in contact with the thing you want to measure. So light is a very convenient way of measuring things at a distance from the thing you want to sense. And of course, the classic example is your eye, which can see things without being in contact with them, etc., and sense things. And so light, if you look at the general description of light, light is just part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and the electromagnetic spectrum is defined by what's called its wavelength, which has to do with how fast the electromagnetic field changes with time. And so you have this thing called wavelength, and so out here you have short wavelength, high energy things like gamma rays and X-rays, then ultraviolet, and then visible light, and then what's called the infrared, which the wavelength gets longer, then microwave, and then radio waves, etc. And this gives you a feeling of the scale of the wavelength. So the scale of the wavelength of electromagnetic radiation goes all the way from down to the scale of nuclei. So this is 1,000 billionth of a meter out to thousands of meters in radio waves compared to gamma waves. And notice that visible light, that which our eye is sensitive to, is only an incredibly small fraction of the electromagnetic spectrum. And of course, this happens to be the peak radiation that comes from the sun. And of course, we have evolved over hundreds of millions of years or millions of years so that our eyes are sensitive to the light that comes from the sun, which is peaks at in the visible spectrum. And we're familiar with the fact that, you know, light can have colours ranging from red to blue. So I'll use the term colour in a general term to describe different wavelengths of the electromagnetic spectrum, even though it's not necessarily visible. Okay, so think of light having colour, which is what your eye is sensitive to, and of course the colour of an object can tell you a lot about the object, right? And similarly, the colour of infrared radiation can tell you a lot about the object as well, but we can't see it. And the reason for that is because in the infrared spectrum, which, just to remind you, is using wavelengths of light that are longer than what we can see, the visible light, the wavelengths of light corresponding to the infrared happen to be wavelengths and energies that correspond to how molecules vibrate and rotate and things like that. What that means is that when light interacts with matter or things, whether it be your skin trying to detect skin cancer, or whether it be soil trying to measure carbon content, or whether it be a leaf trying to measure water stress, all of these kind of things. The light interacts with that matter in a way that whereby it's either absorbed or reflected, or sometimes absorbed and re-emitted. It's quite a complex process. And that process depends on these sort of all these vibration of molecules and rotation of molecules in the matter that you're sensing. So what that means is that if I, and it so happens that the energies involved with these physical processes are almost all in the infrared range. And so if I can measure, so this thing here measures the transmission through something as a function of wavelength, and you can see that you get these peaks and troughs and all this kind of stuff. And these peaks and troughs and variations in how that light is absorbed correspond to the specific vibrational modes of molecules in the thing that you're sensing. So if I have this spectrum, as it's called, I can determine what's in that material that I'm analysing. And so that is called spectroscopy. And so spectroscopy, your eye, in effect, is a fairly crude spectrometer, because it determines different wavelengths of light and interprets them in colour, right? Red, blue, green, etc. And basically all your eye is doing is sensing the different wavelengths of visible light. And your brain then interprets that as red, blue, green, etc., and gives the signal that your eye is sensing, converts it into a colour image. And exactly the same thing can be done at other wavelengths. So if you can analyse the colour of light, whether it be in the visible or in the infrared, which is what this instrument does. You can, in the infrared, you can actually analyse what are the constituent elements inside that material, depending on how that light is absorbed, how it's reflected, how it's absorbed and re-emitted, all that kind of stuff. It's quite a complex process, and I'm not going to get involved in that, but just to give you a sense that if I can measure the colour content of light that is absorbed or reflected by something in the infrared, I can analyse the chemical content of that thing. And that instrument is called a spectrometer, and your eye is actually a spectrometer, right? Because it interprets colour based on what your different sensing elements in your eye sense different wavelengths. So this is great. So we have this instrument here called a spectrometer, which can measure the infrared spectrum of light, infrared, and from that spectrum we can determine the chemical species in something. We can determine if something is, you know, something on your skin is skin cancer, etc., etc. Extremely widely used, very well understood, and a technology that exists and is, like as I said, used in very, very many different applications in biomedical sensing, in terms of analysing for diseases and things like that, used a lot in agriculture, as we will see, and used a lot in defence and security applications, because if you can measure the infrared spectrum of something, then you can tell if it has explosives residues or things like this in a defence and security application. Okay, so that's fine, but the biggest problem is that these spectrometers that I just described are, first of all, they're pretty big and expensive, right? They're sort of about this size, sort of a microwave oven kind of size. They're pretty bulky. And they're pretty expensive. They cost sort of something around $50,000 to a couple of $100,000, depending on how sophisticated it is. And they're laboratory-based, because they're quite fragile and sensitive to vibrations. They've got a lot of complex optics in there, which are all aligned, etc. And so, you know, if I drop one of these things on the floor, I'm finished, right? It's not something you can stick in a drone, not something you can put on a tractor, or not something you can carry around in your hand. So they're expensive, they weigh quite a bit, and so clearly a laboratory-based instrument. So that's not really what we want, right? If you're going to do something out on the farm, you want something that's what we call field portable, because if you want something to be field portable, it has to be either handheld, so I can carry it around in my hand, or I can stick it on a pole to look out over the crop and scan the crop or something like that, or I can bolt it onto a harvester to measure things as it comes off the as I'm harvesting grain, for example, or I can stick it on a drone and fly over a crop, etc., and analyze things. So just to give you an example, wheat farmers, when they turn up at a grain silo here in Western Australia, CBH, which is one of the big grain handling companies here, the first thing they do, they have an infrared spectrometer at every grain silo. And the first thing they do is they analyze the wheat with infrared spectrum. They capture the infrared spectrum, and the reason for that is they want to know two things. What's the protein content of the wheat, and what's the moisture content of the wheat? And based on those two numbers, that determines how many dollars per tonne the farmer gets. End of story. There is no discussion, etc. So if you have that information, you can use that information to maximise your profits, right, in terms of either blending wheat, etc. But otherwise, if you don't have it on the farm, you really don't know until you turn up at the grain handler what you're going to get per tonne. Also, this kind of technology can be used to analyse grapes for winemaking. You know, winemakers tell me that the two things they want to know, or the two most important things, is sugar content and something they call titratable acidity, which I have no idea what the hell that means, but it's something they want to measure. And they do it with infrared spectroscopy. But, you know, they can't do it out in the vineyard. They can take a sample and send it off to CSIRO and get an infrared spectrum, and they'll tell them, but then it's too late. They want to know, do I pick the grapes today? The weather's like this. Do I wait another 2-3 days to maximise the sugar content or get it wherever they want it to be, to optimise it for winemaking? So there's a lot of stuff that farmers want to measure, and they want to measure it on the farm. They don't want to measure it in the lab. Okay, so the question is, how do I take something that is, you know, this big and this fragile and this costly and make it something that's small, handheld, that I can stick on a tractor? And of course, that also means it has to be rugged. It's, you know, can't be sensitive to vibrations, etc. Because in the end, ideally you want something, you know, that a farmer can just take and throw into the back of a truck and not have to worry about it. Well, realistically, the only way that you can do that is via using a technology which involves what are called microelectromechanical systems. So microelectromechanical systems are small mechanical things on a scale of microns, right, millionths of a metre. Just to give you an idea, human hair in cross-section is about 100 microns across. And we're talking about making mechanical things that are smaller than that. And that's what microelectromechanical systems are. And microelectromechanical systems, they're so small, and they are very, very rugged. They are not sensitive to vibrations because they are so small. And they are everywhere. Every one of your mobile phones probably has about half a dozen MEMS sensors in it. It's what tells your phone when you rotate it that it's not that way, it's that way. And so it rotates the image based on how your phone is oriented relative to the, you know, gravitational force of the Earth. So your phone has a whole bunch of MEMS sensors in it, and your car has a whole bunch of MEMS sensors in it. The little device that triggers your airbag in your car is a microelectromechanical systems. Little sensor. that basically is so fast and so small that when you slam, if you slam into a brick wall at 60 kilometers an hour, this MEMS sensor detects that sudden change in acceleration because your car is slammed into a wall, triggers the airbag, and hopefully the airbag opens up before your face hits the steering wheel. It's all done with MEMS, microelectromechanical systems. So they have to be small, they have to be fast, and they have to be cheap. And that's basically what makes all these things possible. So this just shows you a few pictures of some microelectromechanical systems that are used for various little things. So for this one shows, for example, is in what's called a digital light projector, which is a whole bunch of little mirrors, millions and millions and millions of them on a chip that basically controls the projector that's sitting up there, has one of these in there that produces this image with a whole bunch of billions of little mirrors. And that's a microelectromechanical system. So they're everywhere, but you're sort of not really aware of them. So the unique thing about microelectromechanical systems, is that they are small, cheap, and lightweight, low power, all that kind of stuff. So how do I make these things? Well, microelectromechanical systems are manufactured in the same kind of facility that manufactures the integrated circuits that run your mobile phone and run your TVs and run all your laptops and things like that, right? So, this shows an Intel Pentium chip, which has about 1 billion transistors on it, and that's what runs your laptop and also your mobile phone, etc. And these things are manufactured in facilities called clean rooms or semiconductor foundry, where you process things wearing all these sort of bunny suits, etc. And you've probably seen pictures of this. And if you're interested, I actually have some silicon wafers here. This particular one here has a whole bunch of microprocessors with on-chip memory, etc. Looks pretty boring, but those little squares in there have, in this particular case, probably a couple of 100 million transistors in that little less than 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter square. So that's the kind of technology that you manufacture integrated circuits from, which are the basis of the whole sort of information age, the internet. Everything runs on those integrated circuits. And so the kind of microelectromechanical systems that I'm talking about allows you to transform that large, bulky, costly laboratory-based instrument into effectively a spectrometer on a chip. And that's what I've got in here. So inside that little package in there is actually a spectrometer, which does the same job as that $50,000 laboratory-based instrument. Once I get it to this size, I can stick it in all sorts of instruments, I can stick it on a drone, I can hold it, have it in my hand and point it at things, et cetera, and essentially do spectroscopy once I do all of the electronics around it and things like that. So that's the kind of technology I'm talking about, and this just shows you some pictures from our semiconductor foundry facility, which is in the electrical engineering building over on the other side of the university where we do our research. And then once you've got that, what that little thing that I showed you has is basically just this microelectromechanical systems filter, which selects wavelengths electrically. It switches and selects the wavelengths, and then that's detected by an infrared detector, and then the signal comes out, and so I can measure the spectrum. I can measure the signal as a function of wavelength, and hence I can measure, determine the spectrum of the light that impinges on the detector. And that's basically a spectrometer. Exactly the same as what your eye does, right? Your eye takes incoming visible light, and depending on the wavelength, it excites certain sensors in the back of your eyeball, and that's interpreted as colour by your brain. Okay, so if we had something like this, a MEMS-based tunable filter, which we do have, and this just shows you roughly the size of it, so this is in one of our test systems over in electroengineering, then you could build instruments around it that sort of encompass the electronics and the signal processing and all of the communication systems. So you can envisage, for example, something that has, you know, this is just shown pictorially with a fiber, optical fiber sensor with a head where this is the sensor at the end here, and it sends a signal via an optical fiber into the electronics here. And in here you could have GPS systems similar to your phone, you could interface it to your phone, and you could walk around a vineyard and take samples and map the distribution of sugar content and grape, and titratable acidity in your grapes, if you wanted to. And so you can imagine putting these on a harvester or in front of a tractor, sensing for weeds or sensing for some other thing, and control what the tractor does in terms of spraying or applying fertilizer to optimize the use in real time while you are on the farm. Right? That's the crucial thing. Or you could have it in a drone which is flying around analyzing crops to determine where I should irrigate, am I getting water stress, etc. And so just to show you what, you know, I've been using the term color, which is not strictly correct once you're outside the visible range, but this just shows you what sort of I'm talking about. This image here is just taken with a mobile phone, right? So it's just a color image, and this is the black and white version of that image. So what this shows you is, as far as the visible light is concerned, that our eye sees and that the mobile phone sees, this is a green bottle and these are green leaves, right? And I can't really tell the difference between them. However, if I put a MEMS filter in front of my mobile phone, which filters out what's called, which has a filter which looks at the red edge, as it's called, what this does now is it can tell the difference between green colour that our eye sees and actual leaf foliage versus green. So this here is a green bottle and these are green leaves, and what this is telling you is these are leaves, this is not. So this just shows you one, in a simple way, how infrared spectroscopy can differentiate between leaves and something else that is green. So if I wanted to measure the foliage on a crop, for example, from a drone, I could simply have the appropriate filter at the appropriate wavelength, and all I would measure is foliage. I wouldn't just measure things that are green. And that's because this red edge is used a lot in agriculture to measure crop coverage and things like that, because chlorophyll in the leaves becomes transparent in the infrared, in the near infrared. Because its reflectance is fairly low, but then at longer wavelength it's very high. And so if I have a filter that separates this region, which is what my eye is sensitive to this region, which is in the infrared region, and my eye cannot see, I can separate leaves from other green things. It's just as an example. But in addition to all that, I can measure some other parameters which people in agriculture are interested in, such as what they call leaf area index and things like that, which, once again, I don't quite understand, but I just work with people in agriculture or people in defence and security or in medical areas who use these sensors for various things. So just to give you some other examples of the kind of technologies we're talking about, if you want to, weed detection is another very useful application of this technology. So if you have an outbreak of weeds of a particular type, quite often nowadays is, you know, once you see or detect weeds, they just blanket spray the whole crop, right? Which is very wasteful from a cost point of view, but also not necessarily something that we would like to have in our food. So with the kind of technology we're talking about, in principle, if you had it, for example, on a drone or something, you could detect weed outbreaks at a localized level. You could GPS the locations to accuracy within centimeters, and then you could just simply locally spray and control weeds in that way, rather than spraying the whole crop because you're not too sure where exactly it is and you don't have a localized map of where the weed outbreaks may be. And that clearly is going to save chemical usage, saves the farmer lots of dollars, and from a consumer point of view, reduces environmental impact as well as reduces the herbicide on food and things like that. Water stress is certainly in the Australian context, as I've mentioned before, is very important because we're a very dry continent, and so we want to maximise the benefit that we get from our water usage. And so if you have irrigated crops, the crucial thing is that you want to water things before they are hit by water stress. Once the leaves wilt on a crop, then the damage is already done. And what you'd like to do is detect before this happens that the plant is stressed from lack of water, and if you can control your irrigation system to only water locally where it's needed rather than everywhere. So at the moment, you know, it's basically monitored by visually, which is difficult and time consuming. You know, you have large farms, you know, you can't walk around between every in fruit production, things like that, down every row of the farm to determine where I should water locally. And so this clearly is a way whereby you can, with a simple measurement from a drone, for example, you could detect water stress before it causes damage and locally irrigate where needed, which varies from time to time depending on the slope of the land. And, you know, there are huge variations across a paddock in terms of the moisture containment properties of the soil and things like that. And once again, you know, you'll hear this pretty much on every slide. You'll reduce the amount of water usage, save money, and reduce environmental impact, etc. And of course, in terms of a farm, if you think of the inputs to the farm, basically you've got the soil and its nutrient content, and then you've got water, etc., and they are the main inputs, as well as, say, fertilizer or herbicides, etc., that produce the crop, obviously, and the produce that comes out. So soil analysis is something that is done, obviously, well, not regularly enough, but it is done occasionally. And the reason it's only done occasionally is because it's very costly. Every sample, which, you know, you take a sample, you send it off, it costs you about $200 per sample, takes a week or two to get your results back, etc. So it's like, well, you might do a sample here and there and get sort of a very rough idea of what's going on in terms of the soil. It would be great if you had something that is so cheap and that you could have multiple of these and simply do the analysis on the farm by simply perhaps a small borehole, analyze the infrared spectrum of the soil in situ, in real time, on the farm, and from that determine the soil status and hence what fertilizer needs to be applied, etc., optimize it specifically to what you measure. Another area is carbon accounting, because farming is one mechanism whereby you can sequester carbon in soil. And carbon is also important because it improves soil health and also the crop. Once again, very sparse sampling is done. You have to send it off to a lab, so it's not in real time, and it's quite costly. You know, I won't go through all these. It's pretty much the same as the previous one. If you could do this in real time on the farm, it would certainly improve the analysis. Now, here's something I don't particularly like to talk about, but I've quoted from a presentation that I heard from somebody in the US who basically talked about fecal contamination in processing of meat, and basically started off by saying that fecal contamination of meat is totally unacceptable, but totally unavoidable. And somebody described to me the nasty things that happen inside abattoirs where basically the thing that you want, which is, you know, the meat carcass, is surrounded by a nasty thing, either a hide or a whole bunch of feathers and skin and stuff, which is generally contaminated with all sorts of stuff. And then running through the middle of that, you basically got a sewage system, which you have to extract without getting any on the meat, etc. And that's just, you know, it's a tough job to do. So this shows you, I mean, these are obviously purposefully contaminated to show the technology, but infrared spectroscopy can successfully detect these things, which unfortunately I don't have a visible image, but you can't see it, right? This is not visible to us in the visible, but in the infrared stands out like a beacon that something's gone wrong, so you need to fix this, right? But once again, people know this, but they really can't apply it because an imaging spectrometer is really, really expensive. And so if you can make something that's low cost, then there's the potential to implement it in every abattoir as carcasses move along a conveyor belt, whatever. You could image the whole thing and determine whether something has to be done to fix a problem. Whoops. And, you know, I've gone through, you know, soil and water and weed infestations and things like that, and also meat contamination. But, you know, infrared spectroscopy, and just last week, for example, there was a big international conference on near-infrared spectroscopy in Europe, which is on every 2 years, and there will literally be hundreds of presentations on the application of infrared spectroscopy in agriculture, because you can measure ripeness of produce, you can test for pesticide contamination, if you have rotten fruit, etc. And then another area that is becoming more and more important is called, in the general term that's used, is food forensics. So the question is, can I detect the original source? So because counterfeiting of food is something that is becoming a bit of a problem. You know, when I buy a bottle of wine, is it really a whatever the label says, or is it just some cheap stuff that's just grown, produced down the road, and they just stick a false label on there? How do I know? How do I assess that? And also contaminants and additives in food products, as well as measuring things like bacteria on chicken, which you can detect with infrared spectroscopy. So I'll give you an example of one I heard, a presentation I heard at that near-infrared conference a couple of years ago, where they used infrared spectroscopy to analyse olive oil, and based on the infrared spectrum, they could tell whether the olive oil came from, in this particular case, it was an Italian group, and they could tell whether the olive oil had originated from Tuscany or Sicily or North Africa. And so when it says on there, you know, made in Italy, what does that mean? Maybe it didn't really come from, it's not really what you're buying. So, you know, this is a major problem for countries like Australia, which have a pretty good reputation in terms of what the food they produce, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, how do you guarantee the genuineness of the article you're buying? Well, realistically, the only practical way to do it is with infrared spectroscopy on a widespread scale. And ultimately, what you'd like to do is put that power in the hands of the consumer, if possible. And so, from our point of view, the ultimate solution is a personal food quality monitor. So why not an infrared spectrometer on everybody's mobile phone, which could be linked to a whole bunch of apps that people have written to analyse wine, to analyse chicken, so somebody walking around a supermarket just wants to check the chicken. Is it okay, or does it have bacteria on it? And your phone already has a whole bunch of stuff on there. You know, it's got cameras, it's got accelerometers, it's got a compass, it's got a GPS system, mobile phone is an incredibly complex system. People don't realise that because everybody sort of carries one around in their back pocket. But even the camera that's in this phone is an unbelievably complicated system. You know, people talk about 10 megapixel cameras, etc. But you know, that phone means it's a 10 megapixel camera has 10 million sensors in there. In fact, it's got 30 million. It's got 10 million red, 10 million green, 10 million blue. Then it combines it into an image, plus all of the electronics around each of those sensors on each pixel to read the signal, and then it has to read it out and create this image. It's an unbelievably complex thing. The only reason, the only reason they can stick it in a mobile phone is because they sell tens of millions of these every month. And that's what makes it cheap. So it's got nothing to do with the complexity of the system. It's got to do with volume. And that's what microelectronics is all about and microelectromechanical systems are all about. You know, a Pentium chip that's in your laptop is probably the most complex system that's ever been designed by humans. And yet, they can produce a image sensor chip for a mobile phone for about $5. That's what it costs the mobile phone manufacturers. And yet it's an unbelievably complex and sophisticated technology to build those things. But volume makes them cheap. It's got nothing to do with how complex it is. So ideally, if you could put a microspectrometer instrument on a mobile phone that I could just point at something, just like I'm pointing this laser pointer, and get a infrared spectrum, I can then use it to measure freshness or spoilage of produce, authentication. You know, vineyards could upload the, you know, have an app which says our 2014 vintage of blah, blah, blah has this infrared spectrum, and you just check and say, oh, doesn't match. Something's wrong here. So in terms of authentication to check for tampering or counterfeiting products, as well as measuring pesticide residues on fruit, allergens, right? Things like peanuts. Does this cake contain peanuts, etc.? You can measure all that kind of stuff with infrared spectroscopy. So this is the ideal ultimate solution. As to how long it might take, I don't know, but that's sort of what we're aiming for. So I'll finish off now and give people an opportunity to ask some questions if they want. So basically, to summarise, this kind of technology that I'm talking about, which is, you know, it's a hardcore electrical engineering technology. Basically, it's a spectroscopic sensor. So if you can make it small, lightweight, low power, has to be low power, because invariably the vast majority of applications are battery operated. And so you can't have something that consumes too much power, otherwise it won't. You can't fly it around in a drone for a couple of hours, etc., and has to be low cost. But the low cost aspect is not really related to the complexity of the technology. As I said, the cost will eventually come down to what the volume is. So if you know, a microspectrometer, maybe if it's only used on a farm and in a doctor's surgery or things like that, you know, it may still be $5,000 to $10,000. On the other hand, if it goes into a mobile phone and starts being produced in the order of millions every month, then the cost will come down to a few bucks. That's guaranteed. And in essence, this kind of technology has the potential to revolutionise farming, because it can decrease wastage, and all of that, of course, and maximise crop yield. Is all about reducing costs, and that, of course, means profits for the farmer. And from the consumer's point of view, improving quality, security, safety, and authenticity, as well as minimising the environmental impact of farming as an industry sector. So I'll probably stop there and give people some time to ask questions. Thank you. Sorry? In 15, oh, okay, that's right. 5 minutes then.
Just the small sensors that you've got, where are you with respect to resolution or the speed of how quickly it can process? Like, is it a single point, or is it something like
or an image.
Camera.
Mm. Okay. All right, first step will be single point, because it's making it large enough to cover a whole imaging system is really, really difficult. So we are working on a spectrometer for an imaging system, but that's mainly for defence applications, because they're the only ones who can afford that kind of stuff. And you can, I think you can imagine what kind of applications they would want to use it for. Sitting in drones, analysing the infrared spectrum. I mean, the defence and security sector, in this business, this technology is almost all came out of defence labs, because infrared spectroscopy is used a lot in analysing from drones and airborne vehicles. Because so the defence labs in Adelaide, for example, have a whole bunch of people that do what's called, determine what are called the spectral signatures of targets. So the way it was described to me by a guy who was a tank commander in the US is, you know, you're sitting in a tank and you have an infrared imaging system, which they all have, and then the question is, I can see this tank 5 kilometres away because I can see this thing sticking out that way and it's got a turret and sort of looks like, it's shaped like a tank, but the question is it a T-72 tank or is it an Abrams tank? The only way I can determine that is with using infrared spectroscopy. So at this stage, yes, we're working on imaging, but that's mainly for defence applications. But for these applications, you don't really need the image. Right? You can have an imaging system that's imaging and point to where something is of interest that you might want to analyse and then just get the spectrum of that generic area.
And how quickly can you do that?
Oh, that could be faster than you can think.
Okay.
Microseconds.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, from an electronics point of view, it's really fast. Really fast. Yep.
You mentioned that you can use this technology for weak detection.
Yep.
And if given the size of the weak, which is a couple of centimeters sometimes, if you want to take in the early stages, and how do you balance between the resolution and the ability of the spectrum to you?
All right, look, as a first step, the way we're working actually with a drone manufacturer, the idea is that there will be an imaging system which sees something that might be different. And if in terms of resolution, et cetera, if it's on a drone, then there's nothing stopping a drone hovering down, getting closer and analysing and then flying off again.
Sorry, I need to wrap that now.
Yep. No problems. I'm around if you want to.